IC. And here, first of all, this is a wire carrying current, and that may be placed in a magnetic field which is perpendicular to the plane of the board. These into marks are indicating the magnetic field, field lines are passing front of the board to the back side of the board. That means the field is like this, north pole is here, and back side may be south pole, we can assume like this. So, this is the wire carrying some amount of current. In this case, the wire also experiences some magnetic force. How much force is acting on this wire? So, F is equal to given as B I L sin theta. Here, B is the magnetic induction used, and I is the amount of current given in amperes, and L is the length of the conducting wire within the field. And theta is the angle between the current direction and the field direction. Here, according to this diagram, where the field is in this direction, the current is in this direction, both are nothing but in the case of perpendicular direction. Here, the theta is said to be 90 degrees. So, see the 90 means sin 90 value 1, so that here in this case, F is equal to B I L. That means, here this wire experiences the maximum force of B I L. For suppose, if the wire is in this direction, same, that means parallel to the direction, there is no force acting on this wire. Why? Because your theta is seems to be 0. So, zero means sin 0 is 0, there is no force acting on the wire. So, only the wire is perpendicular to the field direction that experiences the maximum force. And what is the direction of the force acting on the wire? So, for this, we also follow another rule, that is right hand rule. So, right hand rule. Stretch your right hand in such a way that your three fingers, that means here the thumb finger, the forefinger, and the middle finger, the three fingers are mutually perpendicular to each other like this. In this case, for suppose here the middle finger indicating the direction of the magnetic field. The middle finger indicating the direction of the magnetic field, and the forefinger, here index finger, also indicating the direction of the current. In such a case, here that experiences a force which is along the thumb finger. The thumb finger indicating the magnetic force acting on the wire. So by using this here, by applying this right hand rule here, for suppose here this is the direction of the current with the index finger, and this middle finger is along the magnetic field into the board, and here the force indicated with the thumb finger. That means how this is nothing but towards the left side. So with this force, the wire may be bent towards the left side. This is the direction of the force. Okay, how to change the direction of the force? We can change the direction of the force by changing either the direction of the current or by changing the field direction. That means you can change the direction of the current towards the downward direction, or this may be indicated with the dot symbols. That indicates the field is outwards. In that case, the force is opposite, that is nothing but the right side direction. So you practice these diagrams also, maybe come in examination. Okay, next, based on this concept, here we will explain the device electric motor. Electric motor is very important essay question from this lesson. Electric motor is a device which is used in fans, grinders, mixers, and different instruments, and which converts the electrical energy into mechanical energy. Mechanical energy. That device is called as nothing but electric motor. Here we use this concept. Some force is acting on an armature coil. In general, the electric motor consists of an armature coil. When current is passing through the coil, that is placed in between the two horseshoe magnets. So some magnetic field is there, and the current is passing through the armature. Here the effect, here the force is acting. So, depending on the different torque is applying, and the armature is rotating in between the two magnets. So, that is the basic principle involved in the working of electric motor. You practice the diagram for examination. Next concept is nothing but the induction. Electromagnetic induction. The electromagnetic induction concept was introduced by Faraday. Michael Faraday. He is also conducting so many experiments on this electromagnetic induction concept, and he also stated one law also. And what is the induction? Here, due to the change in the magnetic flux, some of the current is induced in a coil. The concept is nothing but the induction. The current is induced in current. And also here, very famous experiment, you also read it in your from your textbook, Faraday's experiment. And also Faraday last said that here the induced EMF, or suppose epsilon, indicated with epsilon, induced EMF is the rate of change of magnetic flux d phi by dt. So d phi v indicates here the change of magnetic flux with respect to time. So the rate of change of magnetic flux is equal to the induced EMF. That is called as magnetic, Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. Okay, next here we go to Lenz law. Lenz law also very important. Here Lenz law gives you the direction of induced current. Here, according to Lenz law, the induced current will appear in such a direction that it always opposes the change of flux in the coil. So that is called as Lenz law. Next one. Next, based on this electromagnetic induction concept, here there are so many daily applications are there. Very important question. What are the applications of electromagnetic induction while using the ATM cards in swiping machines, and also in induction stoves, and also working of the tape recorders, and also different instruments you are using in security checkup also, we are using electromagnetic induction concept. Next, mainly the generator uses the electromagnetic induction concept. We generates the current, that is nothing but the mechanical energy. Here, the mechanical energy converted into electrical energy. Here, this is opposite to electric motor concept. So, here the mechanical energy is converted into electrical energy by the generator. General generators are of two types, alternating the AC generators and the DC generators. Okay, here they generate the alternating current, this generates the direct current. And how to convert the DC generated into AC or AC into DC, he is asking in examination. And what are the difference between AC generator and DC generator, sometimes asked. The basic difference is here, in case of AC, the current itself changes its direction continuously with respect to time, with the time difference. But to change the direction of the current here in DC, we are using a commutator split rings. That is the basic difference. You practice the diagrams also. Okay, children. The next concept is principles of metallurgy. Here, this is very easy chapter, very small chapter. Here, in case of metals, where we obtain the metals. Metals are mainly abundant from earth crust or the sea. So these are the major sources. And some are due to their reactivity, some are abundant in earth crust as minerals. And some are like gold and platinum, silver, we are occur these metals as an elemental state. So with this, due to this low reactivity. And here the mineral is nothing but the compound, that means the substance which giving the metal, the having the metal. And here, the particular metal from which we extract the metal with a less cost, that means effectively, efficiently, we obtain the particular metal from the mineral, that is called as well. There is a difference. So, all ores are minerals, but all minerals are not considered as ores. That is very important. Every ore is a mineral, but every mineral need not be considered as a ore. Okay? Next, there are different types of minerals such as oxide ores are there, and here sulfide ores, and some are differentiated as chloride ores, and some are carbonate ores, and some are sulfate ores. And different examples are given in the table, textbook. You classify like this. Oxide ores such as bauxite, pyrolusite, magnetite, hematite, like that, zincite. And sulfide ores are galena, cinnabar, zinc blend, and copper iron magnets. And chloride ores are nothing but horn silver, rock salt, and cathode. And carbonate ores are here magnesite and here limestone. And sulfate ores nothing but Epsom salt and limestone. Sorry, and gypsum. These are called as sulfate ores. And here in the metallurgy, there are mainly three stages. The first stage is nothing but the concentration. What is concentrating the ore, concentration of the ore, nothing but also called as dressing. The next one here, that is the second stage, that is extraction. And third one, that is purification, also called as refining. These are the three stages. Here in the case of dressing, here dressing or concentration means removal of the unwanted materials, nothing but impurities. Those impurities are typically called as GAM. Here GAM is nothing but impurities. We remove the impurities to concentrate the ore. So there are different methods are there. That is, one is hand picking or washing, and the main two are froth flotation and also next one is magnetic separation. So these two, along with the washing and the hand picking, these are the major concentration methods. Next one here, the froth flotation is only used for the sulfide ores such as galena and the cinnabar. And magnetic separation, when the ore or the metal may be, means impurity or the metal may be, one may be magnetic in nature, we use this type of magnetic separation. You practice these two diagrams for examination, very important. Next, in the case of extraction, the extraction is taking place based on the activity. This is the activity. So based on the activity, the metals are arranged in the decreasing order of the reactivity. Here, that is called as activity series. What is the activity series? So all the metals are arranged in the decreasing order of the reactivity. Like that, potassium, sodium, calcium, magnesium, aluminium. These are highly reactive metals. Next one, here, zinc, iron, lead, copper. These are moderately reactive metals. And here, Hg means mercury, and Ag, silver, and platinum, and gold. These are low reactive metals. So high reactive metals and moderate reactive metals, and these are the low reactive metals. So from top to bottom, the reactivity is decreases. So this is activity. Based on this only, we can different methods are employed in the extraction. For the high reactive metals, we generally follow the electrolytic methods, and for the second moderate reactive metals, we use different reduction methods. Reduction with carbon, reduction with carbon monoxide, and also auto or self-reduction method, and also the reduction with using highly reactive metals. That is very important in this case, that also called as thermite reaction. In this case, a highly reacting metal is used as a reducing agent, and we extract the low reactive metal from the compound. The thermite reaction generally used to join the rail tracks and also to join the tracks in the machinery parts. That is very important. So you see the reaction like this. Fe2O3, this means iron oxide is used, and aluminium here. Here aluminium is used as a reducing agent in this thermite reaction. Here we obtain Al2O3, and iron in the molten state, because this is highly exothermic reaction, to balance like this. So this reaction indicates thermite reaction. Here aluminium is a reducing agent. Okay, next one, The third step, purification. Here the purification are of different ways. One is a distillation. Next one is boiling. Next one is liquation. Another one is electrolytic refining. Electrolytic refining. Electrolytic reaction. So these are the different four methods, four types of refining methods. In distillation method, depending on the difference in the boiling point, we can apply this type of distillation method. And in boiling, here the molten metal is treated with the logs of wood. So that is called as pores, so that's where the process is called as boiling. And liquation, here that is the difference in nothing but the melting point. The difference in the melting point is here basic for the use of liquation process. And in case of electrolytic refining, generally the blister copper, that is impure copper, is treated. So in blister copper treatment, here generally the blister copper is used as an anode, and the pure copper is used as a cathode. So here from the blister copper, the anode, from the anode to the pure copper cathode, the metal is deposited. So that's why we purify the copper from this blister copper. Next one, here there are some terms are used throughout the chapter. There are nothing but some is roasting. What is meant by roasting? Roasting is nothing but the here heating the ore in presence of oxygen. The process of heating the ore in presence of oxygen is called as roasting. Suppose here in this generally the sulfide ores converted into oxide ores. For suppose PbS is converted into SO2 plus SO2. Here this is the reaction which indicates the roasting process. Right? Next here another important method is calcination. Calcination is completely opposite to the roasting. Here also the ore is heated but in the absence of air. So in the absence of air, the ore is heated, that is called calcination process. In this calcination process, for suppose calcium carbonate is heated, 10 to obtain calcium oxide plus CO3. Here in the roasting process, sulfur dioxide gas is released, whereas in a calcination process, carbon dioxide gas is released. Next, this is the difference between roasting and calcination, also asked in exam questions. Next, another important term is flux. Here, flux is nothing but the material which is joined to ore to remove the gang. So, to remove the impurities, we use some material called flux. If the gang is acidic, flux may be basic. The gang is basic, flux may be acidic. So, flux plus, that is a gang, that mixes together to form and eliminate as a slag. Slag is nothing but the waste material formed in the process, extraction process. And finally, there is another topic also there, that is about the furnace. Generally, furnace are of two types, maybe given in notation or two. One is a blast furnace, another one is a reverberatory furnace. You also differentiate these two furnaces also, you will learn this. And also, every furnace having three main parts. One is hearth, where we place the ore to heat, and also another one is the firebox, having some fuel, and also third part is nothing but chimney, which is the outlet of the waste gases. So these are the parts in the furnace. You compare the blast furnace with the reverberatory furnace also. Okay. From this, all you concluded to prepare well for examination. Okay, children. The last chapter of the textbook, that is nothing but the carbon and its compounds. Here, what is the importance of carbon? Here, you know the atomic number of carbon, that is equal to 6, and the valency is very important character, that is nothing but 4. valence nothing but how many number of bonds it can form. Generally, carbon can form 4 number of bonds. And what are the here? Why the carbon not form 4 plus ion or why it doesn't form 4 minus ions? So it cannot form ionic bond. So there are different reasons you read from the textbook. And also here there are some other characters also there, residual nature of the carbon, like catenation property and forming of different chains, and also isomerism also there, and allotropy also there. So these are the different features of the carbon. By that also we study the various number of compounds of carbon. And here, in case of allotropy, there are different allotropic forms. Allotropy means the appearance of the availability of element in two or more different forms. So they are show the similar chemical properties but different in physical properties. And allotropic forms are of crystalline allotropic forms and amorphous allotropic forms. Amorphous and also non-amorphous, nothing but crystalline forms. Amorphous forms, nothing but lamb black, and also petroleum charcoal, and also coal charcoal, and different sugar charcoal. These are all amorphous forms. And various crystalline lateral forms, nothing but diamond, graphite, and C60, and nanotubes, fullerenes. C60 means magnesium fullerene, nanotubes, diamond, graphite. These are crystalline allotropic forms of carbon. And there is an important question that what is the difference between diamond and graphite also. And right examples of amorphous forms of allotropic forms of carbon and crystalline allotropic forms of carbon, and explain anyone like that question may be asked in examination. Okay, there are some uses of what are the uses of graphite. Maybe graphite usually, you know that graphite is used as a pencil lead, and graphite is a good lubricant. Using lubricants, that's C60, magnesium fullerene. What is the use of magnesium fullerene? Like used to treat the cancer cells, like melanoma. That's nanotubes, as used as a electrical wires. That's used to make the chips nowadays. Maybe technology improves. Okay, there also mean biomolecules. They inject the some biomolecules into the nanotubes, and they inject in medicine also. In nanotubes are used like that also. Okay, next here. The important concept is hydrocarbons. Here, observe the word hydrocarbon. That means hydrocarbons are only having hydrogen and carbon. The hydrocarbons are classified into three ways, mainly here alkenes, and alkynes. Generally, alkanes are nothing but a single bonded compounds. Alkanes are double bonded compounds. Alkanes are triple bonded compounds. Here, alkanes are only called as saturated hydrocarbons, whereas these alkenes and alkynes are combinedly called as unsaturated hydrocarbons. So, this is saturated hydrocarbon means alkanes, and unsaturated hydrocarbon means alkenes and alkynes. Here, A indicating the other means the suffix A indicating the single bond, the suffix E indicating double bond, and I indicating the bond. That means the suffix here in the word indicating the type of bond present. That means the saturation of the bond. Here the general formula also CnH2n+2. Here CnH2n and CnH2n minus 2 are the general formulas of alkenes, and alkynes respectively. So based on that, one can write different names. Like therefore, suppose one carbon that is meth, and two carbons eth, and three carbons that is bromo, and four carbons that is butyl. These are the prefixes. So in this way, so if you use propane, propene, butane, different concepts are there based on that, the number of carbons based on any value. Here you can write the formulas. For suppose in case of butyl, here n is equal to 4, that means C4, so 4 to double switch here is butane. The same way C4 double to the carbon number 8, C4H is butane, and C4H6 is nothing but the butane. So based on this formula, you can write the formulas of each compound. Next, here general characters. Generally, alkanes undergo substitution reactions, whereas alkenes and alkynes undergo addition reactions. Here, there are different types of reactions we see. Here, first suppose, in case of addition reaction, in addition reactions, generally, triple bonded compounds convert into double bond compound, double bond compounds convert into single bond compound. That means alkanes into alkenes, alkenes further into alkenes. For example, one alkane, CH, triple bond, CH, nothing but acetylene. Here, if you add hydrogen addition reaction, that involves one bond is broken and the two hydrogens attached two times. So that converted into CH2 double bonds CH2, which is called as ethylene. So acetylene, ethyne into ethene. So that is nothing but ethylene. Again, first of all, CH2 double bond CH2, this one, ethylene, interacted with hydrogen. Again, we obtain here one bond is broken, the two hydrogens are attached to the two carbon atoms. Here, CH3, single bond CH3, nothing but C2H6, that is called as ethane. So here, acetylene to ethylene and again ethylene to ethane. So ions into ions, ions into ions. So higher carbon hydrocarbons to the lower hydrocarbons to the addition reactions. So this is one example. Next one here, substitution reaction. The substitution reactions undergoing in alkanes especially. For example, in case of methane, the substitution reactions are very important. So suppose methane under UV rays, that means under sunlight, if you add fluorine, here that converted into CH3Cl, methyl fluoride. Again, the CH3Cl is used in case of sunlight or UV light. Then CH2Cl2, methylene fluoride is formed along with HCl. Again, CH2Cl2 is taken to add Cl2. Here, Cl is replacing the hydrogen place. And here the hydrogen number is naturally decreasing and the chlorine number increasing. That means CHCl. Observe this CH3Cl. Here CH2Cl2, 2 plus 2, 4. Here 1 plus 3 also 4. So hydrogen number naturally decreasing, chlorine number increasing. And again, if you see CHCl3, this one plus Cl2, again, the total hydrogen also decreasing. The all of the chlorines are there. CCl4, this is carbon tetrachloride. Also, tetrachloromethane. Also this one is chloro. So this is the continuous reactions, very important for information purposes. And also here there are some functional groups also there. We discuss about the different types of functional groups. Generally the nature, the properties of a hydrocarbon depends on the function group present in the compound. There are mainly some function groups. Alcohol group, which is present with the OH. Next to aldehyde, CHO group, and carboxylic acid group, that is COOH group. Next to ester group, that is represented as COOR. Here, next to MI2, that is NH2, and also here ketone, that is nothing but a CV. So, alcohol OH group, CH2-aldehyde, and COOH is the carboxylic acid, ester is COOR, and MI and NH2 ketone CV. So, these are the different functions. For example, here identify the functional group given in the one compound given. CH3COCH3. Which type of functional group is present? The generally in between middle C. So that is belongs to keto. Okay, next here CH3COOH. CH3COOH group is carboxylic acid. This is a acidic acid. So based on that we can answer different questions. Okay, to practice with the different examples. Here, R is nothing but an alkyl group. R is not an element, R is called as alkyl group. So from any alkane, if you remove one hydrogen, the remaining compound is called as alkyl family. nothing but from ethane CH4. If you remove one hydrogen, then it's remaining CH3. CH3 is called as methyl. And C2H6 is ethane. By removing hydrogen, we obtain ethane. So like that, the propyl, butyl, like that, these are different alkyls. You may join here with a bond, different alkyl groups. You practice these, okay? Here in this chapter, very important, there are two compounds. The one is ethyl alcohol, that is ethanol. Ethanol also called ethyl alcohol, the formula is C2H5OH. And another one is acetic acid, also called as ethanoic acid, that is nothing but the CH3COOH. CH3COOH is acetic acid, ethanoic acid, C2H2OH. Ethanol or ethyl alcohol. And how do you prepare ethanol and what are the properties of ethanol? He is asking in examination. So from the ethene, we obtain the ethanol. We practice the reaction. And also, in case of ethanol or acetic acid, what happens when we add a small piece of sodium? Generally, the reacts with the sodium, both releasing the some hydrogen gas. That is very important observation. First, suppose here C2H5OH plus sodium. Here we obtain Na replaced here with the hydrogen and C2H5ONa. That is nothing but the sodium ethoxide is formed by releasing the hydrogen gas. In the same way, here also in case of acetic acid also, if you take the CH3COOH, also sodium metal reacts with to form here H is replaced by Na. CH3COONa. Sodium acetate here. Here sodium ethoxide, here sodium acetate is formed by using the hydrogen gas. And to balance here, you keep one also, two here, and also here also, two. Right? Here these are the two reactions in which we observe that the hydrogen gas is commonly released when we add sodium metal either to ethanol or to acetic acid. Okay, there are some other reactions also important for the acetic acid with the sodium and acetic acid with the sodium hydroxide and the sodium carbonate and sodium hydrogen carbonate and NaHCO3. In all the cases, very important to know is here every time we obtain the sodium acetate. Either with the sodium hydroxide, sodium carbonate, sodium bicarbonate, generally we have in all the cases sodium acetate, CH3COONa is the product. And but different H2O here is formed here, CO gases, it is here, CO gases released. So you practice those reactions. Next concept is esterification. Very important thing, that is esterification. Nothing but formation of ester. To prepare an ester, generally this alcohol group. This alcohol group and here the carboxylic acid group. Carboxylic acid group combined to get the ester. So alcohol group is OH, ROH, and this is the carboxylic acid is RCOOH, and combined we obtain RCOO. That means here the to this RCOO. Here this R is okay. Here this is OH. So and this H and this OH replace to eliminate out here as H2. So RCOOR is the ester. So ROH is alcohol, RCOOH is carboxylic acid, RCOOR is ester. Nothing but for example, ethyl alcohol, this is an experiment in an esterification experiment. Take 1 ml of ethanol in a tissue and take 1 ml of acetic acid in add to this tissue. Next, add few drops of concentrated sulfuric acid also and take this into a water bath by into the hot water. And this total content is pouring to another 50 ml liter, we obtain a sweet smell, that is the preparation of ester. That is nothing but the sodium ethyl acetate, ester is prepared in that. So you practice the equation also for this. Next one, saponification. Saponification is nothing but the soap formation. And you compare the esterification with saponification also, You read that question also. Next two, very important question from this place is cleaning action of soap. So generally soap clean, soap solution or detergents clean the cross minuet, how they work. So because of formation of a colloidal solution, soap solution, nothing but formation of micelles. Generally, a micelle is a spherical aggregate of all the soap molecules. Generally, soap molecule is like this with the UO minus. This is the carboxy end. This end is also called as carboxy end, which is polar in nature, polar end. And this is non-polar in nature. And this is a hydrocarbon end. Hydrocarbon. This hydrocarbon end is get attached towards the dirt or grease or oil. And this one, COO minus, which is a polar end, get attached towards the water particles. And so this end is known as hydrophilic in nature, and this one is hydrophobic in nature. So in that question, you must draw this simple diagram and you explain how the soap molecules with a small hesitation they remove the dirt from the cloth. So in this way, that is removed, and so cloths are clean. And also you practice the micelle diagram, and also different nomenclature concepts also there, based on the time you practice the nomenclature rules also. Okay children, by based on these process, you thoroughly prepare at home all the lessons with confidence. Very here the preparation confidence is very important. So don't believe the rumors, and only prepare well for the examination, and also all the best for your examination. Thank you.